ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ ಸರ್.
ಸಾವಿತ್ರಿ ಮೇಡಮ್ ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ.
ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ.
ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಸರ್, ಇವಾಗ ನೋಡ್ಬೋದಾ ಪಿಪಿಟಿ ಕಾಣಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದೆ?
ನೋಡ್ಬೋದು.
ಯಾ ಫೈನ್ ಅಲ್ಲ.
ಸರಿ,
ನಾನಿಲ್ಲಿ ಪಿಪಿಟಿ ಮಾಡ್ತೀನಿ ಸರ್, ನೀವು ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ರೆ ಸಾಕು ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಸ್ಲೈಡ್ಗೆ.
ಓಕೆ ಸರಿ.
ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ರಾಮಕೃಷ್ಣ ಅವರೇ ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ, ವೆಲ್ಕಮ್.
ಸರ್ ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ ಸರ್.
ಶುರು ಮಾಡ್ಬೋದಾ ಸರ್? ಶುರು ಮಾಡ್ಬೋದಾ ಸರ್? ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ರಾಮಕೃಷ್ಣ ಅವರೇ ಶುರು ಮಾಡ್ಬೋದಾ? ಹಲೋ
ರಾಮಕೃಷ್ಣ ಸರ್.
ಹಲೋ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ರಾಮಕೃಷ್ಣ ಅವರೇ.
ರಾಮಕೃಷ್ಣ ಸರ್, ಇದ್ರಲ್ಲ ಆಡಿಯೋ ಆನ್ ಇದೆ ಸರ್, ಇದ್ದೀರಾ?
ಹಲೋ. ಆಯ್ತು ಸರ್. ಓಕೆ ಸರ್.
ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ರಾಮಕೃಷ್ಣ ಅವರೇ ಶುರು ಮಾಡ್ಬೋದಾ
ಸರ್? ಶುರು ಮಾಡ್ಬೋದು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಸರ್.
ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ರಾಮಕೃಷ್ಣ ಅವರೇ ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ, ನಿಮಗೆ ಸ್ವಾಗತ. ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ. ನಮ್ಮ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ವಿಜ್ಞಾನ ಮತ್ತು ತಂತ್ರಜ್ಞಾನ ಅಕಾಡೆಮಿ ನಡೆಸುತ್ತಿರುವ ನಮ್ಮ ಪ್ರತಿಭಾವಂತ ಪಿ ಯು ಸಿ ವಿದ್ಯಾರ್ಥಿಗಳಿಗೆ ವಿಶೇಷ ಉಪನ್ಯಾಸ ಮಾಲಿಕೆ ಇದು ಪ್ರತಿಭಾ ಶೋಧ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮದಲ್ಲಿ ನಡೀತಾ ಇದೆ. ಇವತ್ತಿನ ದಿನ ನಮ್ಮೊಟ್ಟಿಗೆ ಬಹಳ ಸುಪ್ರಸಿದ್ಧ ವಿಜ್ಞಾನಿ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ರಾಮಕೃಷ್ಣ ಅವರು ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಹಾಗೆಯೇ ಜೊತೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಅಕಾಡೆಮಿಯ ಸದಸ್ಯರಾದ ಪ್ರೊಫೆಸರ್ ಬಿ ಜಿ ಮುರಳಿಮನಿ ಅವರು, ಪ್ರೊಫೆಸರ್ ಶ್ರೀನಿವಾಸ್ ಸೈದಾಪುರ್ ಅವರು, ಮೇಡಮ್ ಪ್ರೊಫೆಸರ್ ಎಚ್ ಎಸ್ ಸಾವಿತ್ರಿ ಅವರಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅಕಾಡೆಮಿಯ ಸಿಇಒ ಅವರು ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಎ ಎಂ ರಮೇಶ್ ಅವರು, ಮತ್ತೆ ನಮ್ಮ ಸಹೋದ್ಯೋಗಿಗಳು ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಆನಂದ್, ಶ್ರೀ ಉಮೇಶ್, ಶ್ರೀ ಶ್ರೀನಿವಾಸು ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಜೊತೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಪಿ ಯು ಸಿ ವಿದ್ಯಾರ್ಥಿಗಳು ಯಾರು ಆಯ್ಕೆಯಾಗಿ ಬಂದಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಅವರು ನಮ್ಮೊಟ್ಟಿಗಿದ್ದಾರೆ, ಇಲ್ಲದ್ರೆ ಯೂಟ್ಯೂಬ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ನೋಡ್ತಾ ಇರ್ತಾರೆ. ಇವತ್ತಿನ ಉಪನ್ಯಾಸಕರು ಬಹಳ ಸೂಕ್ಷ್ಮವಾಗಿ ಹೇಳಬೇಕಾದ್ರೆ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ರಾಮಕೃಷ್ಣ ಅವರು. ಈ ಉಪನ್ಯಾಸ ಕನ್ನಡ ಇಂಗ್ಲಿಷ್ ಎರಡರಲ್ಲೂ ಸೇರಿ ಮಾತಾಡ್ಬೋದು. ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ರಾಮಕೃಷ್ಣ ಫಾರ್ಮರ್ ಡೈರೆಕ್ಟರ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ಜುವಾಲಜಿಕಲ್ ಸರ್ವೆ ಆಫ್ ಇಂಡಿಯಾ, ಗವರ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಇಂಡಿಯಾ, ಆನರಿ ಸೈಂಟಿಸ್ಟ್ ಬೊಟಾನಿಕಲ್ ಗಾರ್ಡನ್ಸ್, ಯೂನಿವರ್ಸಿಟಿ ಆಫ್ ಅಗ್ರಿಕಲ್ಚರಲ್ ಸೈನ್ಸಸ್ ಬ್ಯಾಂಗ್ಳೂರ್, ಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟ್ಲಿ ಚೇರ್ಮನ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ಸಲೀಮ್ ಇನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಟ್ ಕಮಿಟಿ ಫಾರ್ ಅಟ್ ದಿ ಸಲೀಮ್ ಅಲಿ ಇನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಆರ್ನಿಥಾಲಜಿ, ಹೀಗೆಲ್ಲ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಮತ್ತೆ ಅವರ ವಿದ್ಯಾಭ್ಯಾಸ ಹಾಸನದಿಂದ ಶುರುವಾಗಿ ಮೈಸೂರು ಮತ್ತೆ ಪುಣೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ಡಾಕ್ಟ್ರೇಟ್ ತಗೊಂಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ, ಮತ್ತೆ ಹೊರ ದೇಶದಲ್ಲಿ ಸರ್ಟಿಫಿಕೇಟ್ ಕೋರ್ಸ್ಗಳು ಮಾಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಸುದೀರ್ಘ ಅನುಭವ, 32 ವರ್ಷದ ಸಂಶೋಧನಾ ಅನುಭವ, ಆಮೇಲೆ ಹಲವು ಪ್ರಶಸ್ತಿಗಳು, ಸುಮಾರು 46 ಪುಸ್ತಕಗಳು, 80 ಪ್ರಬಂಧಗಳು, ವೈಜ್ಞಾನಿಕ ಪ್ರಬಂಧಗಳು, ಹಾಗೆಯೇ ಎಲ್ಲ ಸೇರಿದ್ರೆ ಸುಮಾರು 300ಕ್ಕೂ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಅವರ ಕಾಂಟ್ರಿಬ್ಯೂಷನ್ಸ್. ಅದಲ್ಲದೇ ನಮ್ಮ ಪ್ರಾಣಿಶಾಸ್ತ್ರದಲ್ಲಿ ಜುವಾಲಜಿಲಿ ರಿಸರ್ಚ್ ಮಾಡುವಾಗ ವಿಶೇಷವಾಗಿ 7 ಹೊಸ ಪ್ರಜಾತಿಗಳು, ಹೊಸ ಸ್ಪೀಷೀಸ್ಗಳನ್ನ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ರಾಮಕೃಷ್ಣ ಅವರು ಡಿಸ್ಕ್ರೈಬ್ ಮಾಡಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಸೈನ್ಸ್ಗೆ. ಹಾಗೆಯೇ ನ್ಯೂ ರೆಕಾರ್ಡ್ಸ್ ಅಂತ ಕೋರಲ್ಸ್ ಇರ್ಬೋದು, ಮೊಲಸ್ಕನ್ಸ್ ಇರ್ಬೋದು, ಫಿಶ್ ಮೀನು ಪ್ರಜಾತಿಗಳು, ಇದನ್ನೆಲ್ಲ ಅವರು ಡಿಸ್ಕ್ರೈಬ್ ಮಾಡಿ ವರ್ಣನೆ ಮಾಡಿ ವಿಜ್ಞಾನಕ್ಕೆ ಹೊಸ ಜ್ಞಾನವನ್ನು ತಂದುಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಹಾಗೆಯೇ ಎಷ್ಟೊಂದು ಅವರ ಕಾಂಟ್ರಿಬ್ಯೂಷನ್ಸ್ ನಾನು ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಹೋಗ್ಬೋದು. ಸೊ ದೇಶದಲ್ಲಿ ಮತ್ತು ಪ್ರಪಂಚದಲ್ಲಿ ಎಲ್ಲ ಕಡೆ ಎಲ್ಲರೂ ಗೊತ್ತಿರುವ ಸುಪ್ರಸಿದ್ಧ ವಿಜ್ಞಾನಿಯವರು. ಇವತ್ತಿನ ದಿನ ನಮ್ಮ ರಿಕ್ವೆಸ್ಟ್ಗೆ ಹೋಗ್ಬಿಟ್ಟು ತಮ್ಮ ಉಪನ್ಯಾಸ ಕೊಡಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಬಂದಿರುವುದು ನಮ್ಮ ನಮ್ಮ ಸೌಭಾಗ್ಯ ಅಂತ ಭಾವಿಸ್ತೀನಿ. ನಮ್ಮ ವಿದ್ಯಾರ್ಥಿಗಳು ದಯವಿಟ್ಟು ಇದನ್ನ ಕೇಳಿ, ರಾಮಕೃಷ್ಣ ಅವರು ಹೇಗೆ ವಿದ್ಯಾರ್ಥಿ ದೆಸೆಯಿಂದ ಆಮೇಲೆ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ತನಕ ನಡೆದು ಬಂದಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಹಾದಿ, ಅದು ಕೂಡ ನಮ್ಗೆಲ್ಲ ಸ್ಫೂರ್ತಿದಾಯಕ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ. ಮತ್ತೆ ಅವರು ಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟ್ ಮಾಡುವ ಈ ಒಂದು ಫಾನಲ್ ಡೈವರ್ಸಿಟಿ, ಇವತ್ತಿನ ಟಾಪಿಕ್ ಫಾನಲ್ ಡೈವರ್ಸಿಟಿ, ಪ್ರಾಣಿ ಶಾಸ್ತ್ರದ ವೈವಿಧ್ಯತೆ, ಅದನ್ನ ಕೇಳಿ ಬಹಳ ಬಹಳ ಮುಖ್ಯ ವಿಷಯ ಇವತ್ತಿನ ದಿನ. ಒಂದು ಇಡೀ ಪ್ರಪಂಚ ಹವಾಮಾನ ಪರಿವರ್ತನೆ ಅದೆಲ್ಲ ನಡೀತಿರುವಾಗ ಈ ಫಾನಲ್ ಡೈವರ್ಸಿಟಿ ಬಹಳ ಮುಖ್ಯ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ. ಅದಕ್ಕೋಸ್ಕರ ಈ ಲೆಕ್ಚರ್ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ರಾಮಕೃಷ್ಣ ಅವರು ಕೊಡಕ್ ಬಂದಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಮತ್ತೊಮ್ಮೆ ಎಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ಸ್ವಾಗತಿಸಿ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ರಾಮಕೃಷ್ಣ ಅವರಲ್ಲಿ ಕೋರಿಕೆ, ನಿಮ್ಮ ಲೆಕ್ಚರ್ ಕೊಡಿ ಅಂತ ದಯವಿಟ್ಟು.
ಸರ್ ಕೇಳಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದೆಯಾ?
ಕೇಳಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದೆ.
ಶುರು ಮಾಡ್ಲಾ ಸರ್?
ದಯವಿಟ್ಟು ಮಾಡಿ ಸರ್.
ಎಲ್ರಿಗೂ ನಮಸ್ಕಾರ. ಮೊದಲನೇದಾಗಿ ನನ್ನ ಪ್ರೊಫೆಸರ್ ಅಯ್ಯಪ್ಪನವ್ರಿಗೆ ನನ್ನ ಅಭಿನಂದನೆಗಳು ಮತ್ತು ನನ್ನ ನಮಸ್ಕಾರಗಳನ್ನು ತಿಳಿಸುತ್ತಾ ಇವತ್ತಿನ ಒಂದು ಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟೇಷನ್ ಅಂತ ಏನಿದೆ ಅದನ್ನು ನಾನು ಶುರು ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೇನೆ. ನನಗೆ ಕೊಟ್ಟಿರೋ ಹಾಗೆ ನನಗೆ ಫಾನಲ್ ಡೈವರ್ಸಿಟಿ ವಿತ್ ಸ್ಪೆಷಲ್ ರೆಫರೆನ್ಸ್ ಟು ಇಂಡಿಯಾ ಅಂತ ಒಂದು ಸಬ್ಜೆಕ್ಟ್ ಅನ್ನ ಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾರೆ. ಅದ್ರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ನಾನು ಒಂದೆರಡು ಮಾತಾಡೋಣ ಅಂತ ಅಂದ್ಬಿಟ್ಟು ಅನ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದೇನೆ. ಸೊ ದಯವಿಟ್ಟು ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಸ್ಲೈಡ್ಗೆ ಹೋದ್ರೆ ಉತ್ತಮ. ಎಸ್, ನಮ್ಮ ದೇಶದಲ್ಲಿ ಎಸ್ಪೆಷಲಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಕಂಟ್ರಿ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಎ ಕ್ರೈಸಿಸ್ ಎಸ್ಪೆಷಲಿ ಇನ್ ರೆಸ್ಪೆಕ್ಟ್ ಟು ದ ಬಯೋಡೈವರ್ಸಿಟಿ. ಅಂಡ್ ದಿಸ್ ಬಯೋಡೈವರ್ಸಿಟಿ ಕ್ರೈಸಿಸ್ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಈಸಿಲಿ ಸಬ್ಜೆಕ್ಟ್ ಟು 4-5 ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಂಟ್ ಆಸ್ಪೆಕ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಇಟ್. ದ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಒನ್ ಇಸ್ ದಿ ಲಾಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಹ್ಯಾಬಿಟಾಟ್, ದಿ ಸೆಕೆಂಡ್ ಒನ್ ಇಸ್ ದಿ ಇನ್ವೇಸಿವ್ ಸ್ಪೀಶೀಸ್, ದಿ ಥರ್ಡ್ ಒನ್ ಇಸ್ ದಿ ಓವರ್ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಪ್ಲಾಯಿಟೇಷನ್, ದಿ ಫೋರ್ತ್ ಒನ್ ಇಸ್ ದ ಪೊಲ್ಯೂಷನ್, ಅಂಡ್ ಲಾಸ್ಟ್ಲಿ ದಿ ಕ್ಲೈಮೇಟ್ ಚೇಂಜ್. ದೀಸ್ ಆರ್ ದಿ ಎಲಿಮೆಂಟ್ ದಟ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ದ ಮೇಜರ್ ರೋಲ್ ಟು ಪ್ಲೇ ಇನ್ ಅವರ್ ಬಯೋಡೈವರ್ಸಿಟಿ ಇನ್ ಅವರ್ ಕಂಟ್ರಿ ಆಸ್ ವೆಲ್ ಆಸ್ ಎಲ್ಸ್ವೇರ್. ಸೊ ಐ ಜಸ್ಟ್ ಗೋ ಇನ್ ಟು ಸ್ಲೈಟ್ಲಿ ಡೀಟೇಲ್ ಬಿಫೋರ್ ಟೇಕಿಂಗ್ ಅಪ್ into the faunal diversity with special reference to the India. May I request the next slide, please? Next slide. Now, look at the invasive species that we are facing. Invasive species are those animals and plants that have come from outside and created a havoc for our own species. Look at the first one is the Lissa catena, or commonly known as the giant African snipe. We have the tilapia, we have Clarias gariepinus, we have Pterygophlyctis. These are some of the fishes that have caused a major role in our country. So these are some of the invasive species. Besides, we have got a lot number of plants like Icaria plant, the lantana plants. So these have caused a major role in the destruction of our own wild species. Next one, please. Now, looking at the photograph, you can see 1988 taken as a base. We are completely observing that many of the species are in the threatened list. Now, what are these threatened lists? These threatened lists are nothing but the IUCN criteria or the red list criteria where we assess the status of a species. If you look at the species at the shrubland or a grassland, if you look at the species that are terrestrial, if you look at the species at the forest or the freshwater or the marine ecosystem, from the 1988 till 2020, we are just observing there is a slow decrease in the availability, abundance, diversity. In every respect, there is a decrease. So more and more number of species are in the threatened list. Next one, please. So as a result of which, if you just look at the footprint and the biocapacity, it is a linear between 1970 to 2050 or 2060. But here is a case where it has gone beyond and it has come down to such an extent that it is not possible for us to look at it from an angle. So it is for this reason. Now we are going to take up with the next one, please. The next one, please. So, in addition to that, what we have seen, there are five extinctions during the entire course of the geological history. And in the course of the geological history, we have seen 5 extinction. We are in the phase of the 6th extinction. Now, what has happened in the 6th extinction is the rate of species destruction has come to such an extent, 1 in 1,000 is completely, or there are 10,000 species are lost every day or every month. So that is the number of species that we are losing in the whole of the world. So we are in the stage of 6th extinction. So we have to take sufficient action to prevent the 6th extinction or to delay the 6th extinction. We have lost lot number of animals. For example, during the Triassic period or the Jurassic period, we have lost the entire dinosaur. During the Devonian period, we have lost the entire fish as a whole. So that is the reason why we have to delay the 6th extinction. The next one, please. Now, usually this extinction is always related to the human production, human population. Look at this graph. The human population is increasing. We are almost reaching to the 8 billion mark. And at the same time, the number of plants and number of animals are in this lower rate. So that is the reason we always relate the extinction with the human population. Next one, please. Now, it is for this reason. Way back in 1992, an Earth Summit was held at Rio de Janeiro, Brazil on 5th June 1992, wherein 150 countries participated and took a decision that we should stop this extinction rate. And it is for this reason they have formed a goal. And the next one, please. There is a goal for this 6th Convention of Biological Diversity. The Convention of Biological Diversity refers to 3 important criteria or 3 important goals. The first one is the conservation of biological diversity. The second one is the sustainable use of its component. And third one is fair and equitable sharing of the benefits arising from the genetic resources. Now, if you look at it, because of the loss of species, we have to conserve them. So this is one of the idea of the biological convention on biological diversity, 1992. The second one is we have to use it. But before using it, we have to see that on how much we are left to the next offsprings. So that is sustainable use of components. And whatever benefit that we get from this one has to be shared. That is fair and equitable sharing of benefits. So this took, actually, though it was in 1992, the third important point, the fair and equitable sharing of the benefits, took nearly 20 years to implement. It was only in 2000 it was implemented, and it was in India, it was implemented in 2002 by acting at what is known as the Biodiversity Act of 2002 and the Biodiversity Rule of 2004. Next one, please. So you have to understand what exactly the biodiversity is. The biodiversity is defined, next one. The biodiversity is defined as the variability of the life forms, the variability at all levels, the variability in all combinations, or in other words, it is the variety of genes, it is the variety of species, or variety of habitats, or variety of ecosystems. This is what is known as the biological diversity that has been defined in 1992 in the Convention of Biological Diversity, or Convention on Biological Diversity in 1992, held at Rio de Janeiro of the Earth Summit. Next one, please. It is a simple definition. It is defined as, biodiversity is defined as the total variety of life on Earth. Biodiversity is defined as the total variety of life on Earth. It includes genes, it includes species, it includes ecosystems, and all the ecological processes in which they are a part. This is what the definition of the biodiversity. So that means to say, it is defined as the genetic diversity, it is defined as the species diversity, or it is defined by the ecosystem diversity. These are the 3 levels of biological diversity that has been taken up. Next one, please. Or in Kannadadalli heladadre, idanna vamshavaya athwa jeenugala vaividhyate, prabhedagala vaividhyate, athwa jeevavasagala vaividhyate, athwa it also includes the cultural diversity or sampradayikala vaividhyate. These are the 3 levels of biodiversity. Next one, please. Nodi, just look at it. We have more than 1,000 varieties of mangoes. India is the host country where we have more than 1,000 varieties of mangoes. So similarly, this is one of the examples that we normally give for a genetic diversity. Next one. Now, look at it. These are the three important classes that provide human food. These three classes are the corn, the wheat, and the rice, which provide about 60% of the human caloric value. Look at this one. These are the genetic variations that we come across in the corn. Next one, please. Now, India is very lucky to have one of the host that is known as the Gallus gallus. This is the wild variety of the poultry. From this, we have got a different breeds. As on today, we have got what is known as 21 breeds. 19 has been identified and recognized by the Animal Genetic Resources, Bureau of Animal Genetic Resources, but actually 21, 19 has been registered as the breeds of this one. So this is the wild variety. From the wild variety, because of the genetic variation, we have got 21 breeds of poultry. So this is how a genetic variety is defined. Next one, please. Now look at this one. This is what is called the islands protein. You can different islands proteins are there. This is the type of a genetic variety that we get from different people throughout the world. This is an example that we normally give for the genetic variations or the genetic variety. Next one, please. Now, in the recent past, we have the coronavirus variants. Look at this one. There are mutations. The mutation to the extent of 18 or 21 or 8. So these are the genetic variations that we normally give for the genetic diversity. So these are some of the examples we give normally for the genetic diversity. Next one, please. Now, from this one, what exactly happened is we have opened several vistas or several avenues to take up this genetic diversity in the form of plant biotechnology, in the form of animal biotechnology, microbial biotechnology, marine biotechnology, medical biotechnology, or gene therapy, gene screening, so stem cell biology. So these are the emerging areas mainly based upon the genetic variation or the genetic diversity. Next one, please. So look at this. So these are some of the photographs that I have taken from the water birds. So this is how a different type of variety or the difference diversity of animals, diversity of birds we can see in the water. So this is what is known as the species diversity. Species are different. So species diversity, as all of you know, that the species has been named by none other than Carlos Linnaeus, who has given a name for every animal and plant by two names. One is the genus name, the second one is the species name. So every name has been given with the binomial nomenclature. So this is the species diversity. Next one, please. So look at this one. This is again a species diversity example for the sake of species diversity. I have taken only the species that are available in the Kaveri River system. There are nearly about 53 species of Pontius are present. So the genus name is the Pontius, but look at the species. The species are different. Maybe Conconius, Sarana, or Daniconius, Denisoni are different one. So this is how the species diversity examples of a species diversity is given. Next one, please. So this is the continuation. This next one is also look at this one. The genus is same, the Pontius, but the species are different. This is an example for a species diversity. Now this here is a place. We have taken a Maharashtra as a criteria. There is a place known as Kolhapur. In the Kolhapur, there is a plateau. This is known as the Kas plateau. In the Kas plateau, what we have done is we have taken an example for about 10 meters by 10 meters. This is the species diversity of the plant in that 10 meter by 10 meter. So this is the species example for a species diversity in a place like Kas plateau in Kolhapur. So this is how we give example for a species diversity. This is one of the criteria of biological diversity or convention on biological diversity. Next one, please. Now, we go to the third level. The third level is known as the ecosystem diversity. The ecosystem is defined as an interaction between the plants, the animals, the microbes with the abiotic components. So this is the definition that normally we give. This interaction between the plants and animals and the microbes with their abiotic components. The abiotic components may be climate, may be sunlight, may be temperature, may be precipitation, may be elevation, soil, and land forms. So this is how an interaction takes place, and that is how an ecosystem is formed. Next one, please. Now look at the number of ecosystem that we have got. India is fortunate to have all the ecosystems in the world that we define. It may be a forest ecosystem, it may be a marine ecosystem, it may be a freshwater ecosystem, it may be a grassland ecosystem, it may be a desert ecosystem, a mountain ecosystem, wetland ecosystem, estuaries and backwater ecosystem, or a mangrove ecosystem. Name any ecosystem in the world, we India is fortunate to have all the ecosystems in the world. This is one of the important aspects of an Indian component, that is India is fortunate to have all the ecosystems. And looking at the ecosystem, next one please. Looking at the ecosystem, there are certain functions, and these functions are known as the ecosystem services. And this ecosystem will give three important functions. The number one is known as the provisioning function, the second one is known as the regulating function, the third one is known as the cultural function. These are the benefits that we get from the ecosystem. Now look at the provisioning. The food is coming out from the ecosystem, or freshwater ecosystem, or the wood and fiber, fuel. These are some of the examples for the provisioning. If regulating, the climate regulation is one of the important aspects of the ecosystem services, and cultural ecosystem like aesthetic, spiritual, educational, and recreation. So all these three together, one is the genetic diversity, second one is the species diversity, and the third one is what we call it as the ecosystem diversity. All these three together form the biodiversity. Biodiversity of the or the convention on the biological diversity. Next one, please. Now, the second important aspect is that on the climate, I said the climate. Very recently, all of us know, in the month of November, the Honorable Prime Minister of India has gone to this one to discuss about the climate, how the climate has an impact on the entire biodiversity, ultimately affecting the human population. So this is what has happened in the recent conference held in the month of November, last month only, at the Ireland or United Kingdom. So this is how we have taken up the climate change is the most important factor for the biodiversity conservation. Next one, please. Now, I also told you that in addition to that one, what we have got, the plants, animals, the human being is the center for all these things. So this is what we call it as the cultural diversity. The cultural diversity also goes with the biological diversity system. So all these taken together is known as the Convention on Biological Diversity. This we need to understand before we understand about the faunal diversity of India. Next one, please. Now, if you look at there are three types of diversity. Normally, we measure the diversity with various indices, diversity indices, but we calculate or we work out the type of diversity, and this type of diversity is not is known as alpha diversity, beta diversity, and gamma diversity. Alpha diversity usually refers to a selected habitat, whereas the beta diversity refers to a rate of increase between the two sampling points. And the gamma diversity, usually a full diversity of the entire area or the landscape. So this is how type of diversity is measured by alpha, beta, and gamma. And there are various indices are used, and we do not go into the detail about the indices of the diversity or diversity indices. Okay, next one, please. Now, the next question that comes to our mind is how many animals and plants are there? There was a time when we had Irwin as early as 1992, he said there are 30 million plants, animals are there. Then come back to 1998, 1991, 1992, 2000, 2001, 2005. So in 2005, they believed there are about 10 million species of plants and animals on the earth. This is what we thought about it. Now let's go to the next stage. What has happened? Whether this fact is true or not? How many exactly the species are present on the earth? Next one, please. Now look at this one. There was a time when Wilson from United States, Wilson said that one, there are nearly about 90% of the animals and only a small part of the plants. This is what he has calculated in 1992. What is the present situation? 2010, 2011 is more or less same, but we are slightly increasing the amount of numbers of animals that came to 90%. But look at the present scenario. The scenario is entirely changed. It is not the number of plants and animals. It is the microbes that play a major role. That is the reason we can estimate to the extent of about 30 million species are present on the earth. Now, including the microbes, the microbial diversity has not been estimated so far at all. So this is the study, the present study says that one, there are large number of microbes, that is 78% of the microbes, 7.3% of the animals, and only a small percentage of plants and a major percent of the bacteria and viruses. So we need to understand the microbial biodiversity. Next one, please. So if you look at this one, a major part of the biodiversity are the insects. Nearly about more than 2 million insect population can be assessed, and among the animals, the insect is the major one that plays a major role. And among the plants, the fungi has been completely taken out from the plant kingdom. Now it is a separate group itself as on today. So fungi is the next one. So next to insect is the largest group, is the fungi among the plant kingdom. Next one, please. Now, in 2011, Zhang et al. Has estimated, this is a more or less a correct estimate, this is more or less about the number of animals that are present. He said that nearly about 15,52,300 species in 40 different phyla in an evolutionary sequences. So that is what he has estimated, nearly about 15,52,000. Now, as on today, it is about 10 years old or one decade old. Now we can expect about 16 million species or 16 lakh species as on today. Among them, nearly about 12.5 lakhs are only arthropods. And among the 12.5, nearly about 12.50 as on today are the insects. That means to say 60% of the total scenario of the world is mainly made up of insects, apart from the bacteria and viruses, which we have not estimated so far at all. Then comes the various other groups. So this is how the latest number of animals that are present is nearly about 15.52 and 2011. Now it can be about 16 lakh species in the 40 different phyla are present in the world. This is the number of species that has been recorded throughout the world. Next one, please. Now, among the animals, the major role is the polyopterans. The polyopterans are the major role, which is almost about 50% of the animals are the polyopteran insects. So this is how we can say 51% is the polyopteran, followed by the hemiptera 22%, and followed by Blattidia and Arthoptera, Plecoptera, and all other groups are the smaller or minor groups. So this is a major group of these insects are the polyopterans or this group. Next one, please. Now, let me also tell you something about the plant kingdom. Now, this is a recent one. This is about the number of plants in India is about 40. I'll tell you about the animal, the number of species animal. 1,06,666 is the number as on today recorded as far as the animals are concerned. As far as the plants are concerned, nearly about 50,000. Among the 50,000, nearly about 18,666 are known as the angiosperms or the flowering plants. 16,666. Among the 18,666. Among the 18,000, nearly about 8,000 to 9,000 species are only used as a medicinal plant. So nearly about 9,000 species are used as a medicinal plant. So you can imagine how much important of the plant. Next one, please. This is the total scenario of the plant. It is for this reason. The India is called as a mega biodiversity country. Vishala Vaividhya Deshadalli, there are about 17 mega biodiversity countries in the world, and India is among them. So what exactly is mega biodiversity? Where the number of species of plants, animals, and the microbes are more in number than we call them. Now we also look at this graph, I look at this picture. Most of these mega biodiversity countries are located along the equator. Most of these located along the equator, either north of 23 or south of 23 from the equator. So this is most of them are known as the mega biodiversity countries or mega diversity countries. So India is one among the 17 mega biodiversity country because the number of plants are about nearly about 50,000. Number of animals are more than slightly about 1 lakh species. So it is for this reason that we call them as a mega biodiversity country or Vishala Vaividhya Deshadalli Idu Ondu. Next one, please. Now, in addition to that one, India is again a unique country. Look at the second left one, the Papua New Guinea, Nigeria or Cameroon. These are the highest cultural diversity because they speak more than 200 languages. Look at the other side of it, that is Colombia, China, Peru, Malaysia, Ecuador and Madagascar, where the diversity of plants, diversity of animals are more in number. Look at the central point like India, Indonesia, Australia, Mexico, Zaire and Brazil. These are having both the cultural diversity as well as biological diversity. So India is unique among them because it has both the highest cultural diversity, highest biological diversity. To give you an example, if you look at the constitution of India, there are about 22, now the 23 languages have been identified. But if you just see the number of official languages, that is 22. But the number of languages spoken is about 121, but the dialect is more than 19,500. That is why we are a good example for a mega biodiversity countries having both highest cultural as well as the biological diversity. Next one, please. Now, you also need to understand what exactly the value of the biodiversity. If you want to look at the value of the biodiversity, I'm not going to detail about the genes and the genes, how the genes can play a major role and how much we can calculate upon a single gene. But I'll just give you one or two examples about the breeds of India, the animal domestic cattle, domestic animals of India. Next one, please. Look at the number of domestic animals, the number of breeds that we have got. India is fortunate to have nearly about 202 breeds of domestic animals, of which nearly about 50 are cattle, 19 are buffaloes, 34 are goats, 44 are sheep, 7 are horses, 9 camel, 10 pig, and 19 number of chicken or the poultry, and 2 duck, 3 geese, and 3 breeds of dogs. Out of 3, we have the highest of all, very best one is the Modol from Karnataka, which is nowadays used in military operations also. So this is the breeds that we have got, domestic animals. Look at the importance of these breeds. Next one, please. So India is fortunate to have nearly about 50 breeds, and Karnataka is equally fortunate to have 6 breeds, including the recently identified Malnad Gidda. So we have 6 breeds of cattle in there. Now, what has happened with these breeds? India has become the largest producer of the dairy product, and the milk output has touched a record of 180 million, million kgs or liters. So this is what the importance of a biodiversity. I'll give you another example from the same one, is the poultry. Next one, please. Poultry. Now, poultry, I said there are about 21, 19 has been recognized or what is known as registered. Among them, we have got highest number 19. Nowhere in the world we have so many breeds of poultry are present. And this is the Gallus. Gallus is the original from where the different breeds have come out. Now, next important, next one, please. Look at this one, importance. Look, India's poultry market consisting of the broilers and eggs has reached a value of nearly about 2,000 billion Indian rupees, 2000 Indian rupees, 2000 billion Indian rupees in 2020. And India also has become one of the largest producer of the eggs and broiler meat. So this is an advantage only for the 2 examples that we can just look at. Look at the example from the fisheries, look at the example from the various plants that we have got, plants and plant derivatives. So we can imagine what exactly the significance or the importance of the, or the value of the biodiversity, what we have got today. Next one, please. Now, the second question, the next question that arises is, where are they distributed? Where are these animals distributed? Next one, please. Now, we have to again go back to the history, our biogeography. Biogeography is nothing but the study of the plants and animals and their distribution in space and time. That is known as the bio definition for a biogeography is what is known, the distribution of plants and animals in space and time is a normal definition for a biogeography. And if you look at the inset, this was the situation about 250 million years ago. At 250 million years ago, the entire world was made up of a single unit or a supercontinent or what we call the Pangaea. This Pangaea is separated into 2 parts. The northern part is known as the Laurasia and the southern part is known as the Gondwana. We are a part of a Gondwana. India is a part of the Gondwana's islands. Now look at this one, how it was closely attached together and how it has separated over the years. It took about 100 million years to separate from the what is known as the South America to the Africa. It also took nearly about 100 million years from India, from the Africa to the attached towards the European continent, especially India. India was inside a sea, and this sea was known as the Tethys Sea. And India was attached with the South Africa at one time about 100 million years ago, then got separated and attached with the Madagascar, then detached from Madagascar, then went to Seychelles. From the Seychelles, it moved north and northeast and ultimately attached with what is known as the European continent or the Palearctic continent. So that is how a new set of system, mountain system has formed, that is the Himalayan mountain. Himalayan mountain is just about 10 million years old. So this there is a collision of the plates, the Indian plate with the European plate, and thus formed the youngest child of mountain. The youngest chain of mountain is what we call it as the Himalayan mountains. So Himalayan mountains is the youngest, just 10 million years ago it has formed, and that is the reason is the highest tectonic activity, and this tectonic activity has resulted in the formation of new species. Of speciation is highest in the Himalayan belt. This entire movement of the plates throughout the world from the original supercontinent or Pangaea to the various parts of the world is what is known as the plate tectonic theory. So that is been given by 1932. So this is one of them which was not agreed in 1932, but we know that one, the plate tectonic theory has played a major role. Now there's another important point. I was discussing about the distribution of animals. Look at this one. It was attached with the Africa. So there are many African elements present in India. It was attached with the Madagascar. So there are many plants and animals present in Madagascar, present in India. India has its own, that is one of the autochthonous, or its own animals and plants. So we have got three types. But once it joined with the Asia Minor or the Asia, then some of the plants and animals came from the Asia into India. So it has come from that side. And at the same time, it has also come from the Indo-Chinese and the Indo-Malayan. So this is how the most of the plants and animals that are present today in India is a mixture of its own, mixture from the other countries. So that is a hypothesis. This is hypothesis, what we call the biotic theory hypothesis, wherein some plants and animals migrated from India to the other countries. That is out of India hypothesis. Some plants and animals came to India. That is one of the into India hypothesis. So India is a mixture of many plants and animals which is coming from the other countries. At the same time, many plants and animals have gone into the other countries also. So these are the two important. So if you want to look at the distribution is also from our own, distribution from the other countries also. This is one of the important aspects on the continental drift theory. Next one, please. So we have, if you look at this one, we have a history of more than 50 million years. If you look at our own neighbor, that is what is on the Western Ghat, if you look at that one, it has got a history of 50 million years. And all plants and animals belong to Gondwana derivatives, Peninsula endemics, Madagascaran, Indo-Chinese, Malayan, and Palearctic elements. So this is how the entire scenario of the world, we have got a mixture of all plants and animals in our own country. Next one, please. Now, these plants and animals throughout the world are located in a certain, I just told you when I described about the mega biodiversity countries. So most of these mega biodiversity countries are located along the equator. But these equatorial positions are having the highest diversity. There are various theories for why it is more in the equatorial position. So we will not go into the detail about it. So these places have got the highest number of animals and plants, what we call the species richness. Highest number of its own place, that is the geographical place, species endemism, and number of threatened and endangered species. Nowadays, we don't use the word rare, threatened, and endangered. It was, or in botany only they used red species, but in zoology, we don't use the word red species. Normally, we follow the IUCN criteria. No rare, threatened. We always called all threatened. All threatened animals includes the endangered, so critically endangered, and the vulnerable category. Then the complementarity, the taxonomic distinctness, and degree of habitat loss, all these three criteria make them or what is known the biodiversity hotspot. Next one, please. And Conservation International has identified 36 hotspots in the world. 36 hotspots. The recent one is the 36. Earlier it was 35. Now one more is added in the Australian region, Eastern Australian region. That's how it has become 36. So currently we have 36 biodiversity hotspots. And in the next one, please. India is fortunate to have 4 biodiversity hotspots. Please remember, India is fortunate to have 4 biodiversity hotspots. What are those biodiversity hotspots? One is, earlier the northeastern region is considered as a hotspot. But now that area has been completely taken out. The entire Himalayan belt. The entire Himalayan belt is what is known as the biodiversity hotspot. The first biodiversity hotspot is from the Arunachal Pradesh up to the western part of India is the entire stretch, including the Bhutan and the Nepal. So the central region. So these are known as the biodiversity hotspots. And this biodiversity hotspot, the entire region of what is known as the Himalaya is known as the biodiversity hotspot. The second one is below this, in the northeastern region, below the Arunachal Pradesh, below the Barak Valley or the Assam Valley. So all these places up to Andaman, Andaman is included, Burma and Andaman is included, all these known as Indo-Burmese hotspot. All 7 sister states of northeastern India and the Andaman island is known as the Indo-Burmese hotspot. This is the second hotspot. The third hotspot is known as the Malian hotspot or Sundaland hotspot, and in which a small part of the Nicobar is present. That is, the Nicobar is considered as a Sundaland hotspot. And the last one is what I am just going to detail, more detail about it, is what we call the Western Ghat hotspot. And this Western Ghat hotspot starts from the Dang district of Gujarat, goes up to Kanyakumari with a small gap. And this gap is what is known as the Palghat gap, close to Coimbatore, where Siravani River runs. The next one. So these are the biodiversity hotspots, so where the plants and animals are not. Now, if you just look at the biodiversity hotspot in our own place, that is the Western Ghat, you can see in before 2 years back, there were 14 different frogs were identified as new to the science. So this is how the potentiality of this particular area, Western Ghat, to this one. Now, if I look back to my own career, way back in 2000, we have just completed only 200 frogs in India. Now in 2021, 439 frogs are present. With a matter of 20 years, in a matter of 2 decades, we have identified as many as 239 extra, that is 439 has become the total number of frogs. So this is a very important area. And I also want to tell you, in 2002, Biju, he is located at the Delhi University, he has identified one species of frog that is known as Nasica Batrachus sahadriensis. Nasica means nose, the front looks like a nose. Batrachus means the frogs. So Nasica Batrachus is the genus name. Sahyadri is the Western Ghat. So the name has been given as Nasica Batrachus sahadriensis. Now this is very important from the 2002 onward, because this has a history of 30 million years, because the same relatives are present, Seychelles. The Seychelles has got the same type of a frog, and India has also same type of a frog. So this has a relation for 30 million years ago. That can also show that when India was once attached to the Seychelles before detaching from the Madagascar. So this is how our importance of a Western Ghat. Next one, please. Now look at the number of what is known as the bats, mammals. These bats, nearly about 119 bats are identified in India. Of the 198, nearly about 59 species are only in Western Ghat. So you can imagine how important is them. If you just imagine one species of bat present in Khanapura district of Belgaum. Kanapura district of Belgaum, there is a small cave known as the Barapida cave. This Barapida cave has got one particular type of a bat nowhere else in the Southeast Asia, and that is known as the Automops rotoni. Automops rotoni is present nowhere else except what is known as the Barapida cave in Kanapura district of Belgaum. So this is known as an endemic species also. So we have a large number of endemic, large number of diversity. India can boast that we have got as many as 119 species of bats, out of which Western Ghat alone has got about 58 or 59 species. Next one, please. Now look at the other one, most charming animal, namely the tiger. This is one of the examples normally we give for the success stories of Indian conservation. Normally we give an example of a conservation strategy that is adopted by India. Way back about 5 years back, it was only 1,300 species of 300 animals, 300 numbers of tigers were present. Now today is more than 300, nearly about 400, 4,000 species are present, 3,900 species or 3,900 animals are present, tigers are present. Out of which, look at the Karnataka. Karnataka is the highest number of tigers, 256. Next comes only Madhya Pradesh with 255. So there's only a jugglery of words, so one or two is different, does not matter. But the highest number is in the Western Ghats. So this is how a conservation strategy has improved. Conservation, that is, we have improved the status of the tigers throughout the India. There are 8 subspecies of tigers. The tigers originated in central India, migrated into the different parts of the world, and one of the subspecies is that Indian tiger or the Royal Bengal tiger, and we have nearly about 4,000 tigers in India and nowhere else in the world. And out of these 8 subspecies, 3 are almost extinct. 3 are almost extinct. So we have got the highest number of tigers in India. So this is one of the examples for normally we give for conservation. The other example we give for conservation strategy or conservation success is the gharials and the crocodiles. And third one is the Indian rhinoceros, one horned rhinoceros, rhinoceros unicornis. So this is another 3 example that we normally give for a conservation which are successful in India. Now there are many other species, but the species have been taken up for conservation. Next one, please. Now, look at the plant diversity also. It is not only the animals that I am speaking. Look at the plant diversity in Western Ghats. As many as 7,400 species has been identified. Now it is about 7,450 species has been identified from the Western Ghats alone. Out of which, 5,588 belongs to the native or indigenous. That is belongs to that one. And exotics, that is what I said, that invasive alien species or the exotics, nearly about 376. And cultivated and all this one. So we have the highest diversity of plants, highest diversity of animals in the Western Ghats. So this is how we can say the diversity. Next one, please. Now, Western Ghats is equally important. Look, various geological formations are present in the Western Ghats. It is made up of nearly about 6 states and 51 districts, and more than 40 tribals are present. 50 tribals are present in the Western Ghats, and it is very close to the Arabian Sea. It controls the weather and the climate as well as the rainfall. And more than anything else, nearly about 40% of the rivers originated in Western Ghats. And this Western Ghats and all these rivers, except a few, all the rivers starts, initiates, or originates from the Western Ghats. It flows eastward. Like Kaveri, Godavari, Krishna, take anything except few like Narmada and Tapti, so, and smaller rivers in the various other parts of the Western Ghats. So it is a highest number of plant and animal diversity. Hence, it has been considered the biodiversity heritage site. Western Ghats, in recent terms, there is a lot of controversy going on with that one. So let us not go into the detail about it, but it has been considered by World, what is known as the UNESCO, has considered as a biodiversity heritage site. Western Ghats as a biodiversity heritage site. Next one, please. Now, this is the reason why the entire, it has got a cultural, outstanding, universal value, the integrity, and the, it meets the World Heritage criteria. Hence, the Western Ghats has been considered as a biodiversity heritage site in 2012. Next one. Now, similarly, I told you about the Indo-Burmese hotspot. I'll not go into the detail. Only one example that I want to cite is what is known as the Hulak gibbon. This is known as the only ape. We have got about 26 species of apes in the world. Out of these 26 species of the apes and the monkeys and the primates in the world, we have got 15. India is fortunate to have 15 species of primates. And one among them is this one, Hulak gibbon. This is an ape. So you can see that one, monkeys, we have got 25 species and 15 species in India out of 25 species in the world, and one species of the Hulak gibbon that is present near the Assam Valley, maybe in various states of the northeastern India. This is one of the examples of an endemic animal that is present in the Indo-Burmese hotspot. Next one, please. Now, we are fortunate to have a large number of places where the animals are distributed. The animals distributed in an area, and these areas are what we call the protected area or protected area network or the conservation area. Now, India is fortunate to have 104 national parks. 104 national parks, 566 wildlife sanctuaries, 97 conservation areas, 214 community reserves covering an area of nearly 5.03. In addition to that one, there are 46 Ramsar sites, 52 tiger reserves. So we are fortunate to have such a huge number of conservation area to protect all our animals, plants at their own site. In situ conservation is what we have located, is protected area network. Next one, please. In addition to that one, we have the highest number of biosphere reserves. As many as 18 biosphere reserves are present in India, and fortunately, the first one in India is none other than the Nilgiri biosphere. Nilgiri biosphere is formed from the part of Karnataka, part of Tamil Nadu, and part of Kerala. All these three states, Bandipur, Mudumalai, and the Periyar, all these three constitute the Nilgiri biosphere. This is one among the southern India, and Seshachalam and also Agastamalai in the Kerala, Seshachalam in Andhra Pradesh, these are in the southern India, and most of the biospheres are located in the northern or central part and the northern part of India, and as many as what is known as 18 biospheres are present. And this has got a very important criteria known as the core and buffer zones, where the core is where no interaction will take place. Buffer zone is where human interaction is allowed. So where the animals and animal plants, as well as the human beings, can easily exchange. That is what is known as the biosphere reserve. In addition to that one, next one, please. India is fortunate to have a very good forest cover. It was more than 32% at one time. Now it has come down to 24.56% as on 2019. Every 2 years, there is a census of the forest or forest census. This is the latest on 2019. 2021 is going on, and that the result will come out only in 2022 and after 2023. So this is the latest census wherein 80.73 million hectares of the total forest cover, and we have got the highest number of achievement in regaining is from Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, and Kerala. Whereas if you look at the extent of forest cover, Madhya Pradesh is the highest forest cover, followed by the Arunachal Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Orissa, and Maharashtra. So this is the forest cover where the animals are distributed. Next, if you look at the next one, please. If you look at this one, there are different type of classification. As many as 16 types of forest or major forest are present, and 258. Maharji has calculated as many as 256 different type of forest, but the major one are 16 according to Champion and Seth. So these are the different type of forest cover. Why I am telling you this forest cover is mainly because the animals distribution is mainly dependent upon the forest also. For example, if you look at it, what is the tropical evergreen forest, most of the animals are the top, most carnivores and herbivores are present on the top or what is the canopy. So distribution is mainly related with the forest cover also. That is the reason we have 16 different type of forest cover, 256 minor forest covers, and the total forest cover is as shown in the diagram or in the picture. Next one, please. So these are the different 16 one. In addition to that, some plantations. Plantation is not taken. So all others are 16 types of forest that is present in India. Next one, please. Now, look at this. We have a distribution of the states based upon the linguistic ideologies. We have a geological map. You can see the geological map where the geology is different. We have a climatic map. We have the annual temperature thermal map. So we are diverse, and diverse in every respect of it. Next one, please. So as a result of which, we have got highest biogeographical location. I have told you about biogeography. So biogeographical location. We have a climate, different type of a climate. So we have got diversified climate, we have got geological diversity, and as a result of it, we have got the highest biological diversity, unique biological diversity, and also the eco-diversity. So all these makes India a unique country. And because of this uniqueness, now we have classified the entire Indian based upon the wildlife into 10 regions. These regions are known as the biotic zones. and this has been divided, subdivided into 26 provinces. These are known as the biotic provinces. For example, just imagine Trans-Himalaya. Trans-Himalaya includes only the topmost part of the Himalayan. That is the Trans-Himalaya, where the number of plants and animals are less. So distribution again related to the distribution of these things. So then the Himalaya, the middle part of the Himalayan. Then we have desert, we have semi-desert, the Western Ghats, the Deccan Peninsula, Gangetic Plain, Northeast India, islands, and the coast. So this is how the entire geographical setup of India has been classified. And because of this classification, we find the distribution of animals also. So distribution of animals is related with the biotic zone and the biotic provinces. Next one, please. Now, in addition to one, what we are telling about the land-based ecosystem. Now, this is the marine ecosystem. India is fortunate to have 6 marine national parks. Two are in Andaman and Nicobar, one is in Orissa, one is in Tamil Nadu, one is in Maharashtra, and one is in Gujarat. Kutch is in Gujarat, Marine National Park in Gujarat. So we are fortunate to have a conservation strategy adopted even into the marine ecosystem. And this is how we got the marine national park. 6 marine national parks has been identified in India. Next one, please. Next one, please. Now look at this one. The Orissa. Look at this one. This is known as the olive ridley, a type of a turtle. The turtle travels as much as 9,000 kilometers from the southern part of the world, namely the South America and the Caribbean islands. From there it comes to Orissa. Some part of it even has been located in Karnataka also, some in Andaman Nicobar. Very rare is sightings of these things, but most of them travel nearly about 9,000 kilometers, comes to Orissa and breeds there, lays their eggs. Hatching takes place and goes back to the sea and goes back to the Caribbean islands. This is what is called Aribada. Is the name that we give for hatching of these turtles present in the entire coast of Orissa. So this is how olive ridley. So this is how a national park has been created to save this olive ridley. Olive ridley does not belong. It belongs to the whole world. It comes about 9,000 kilometers, comes here, lays their eggs and makes the young ones to grow and takes back them to the Caribbean islands. This is how a marine park has been created. So similarly, various strategies are adopted for these marine parks. Next one. Now, we are fortunate. Especially we are fortunate to have a very good diversity of corals also. India is fortunate to have a coral reefs. These coral reefs are present in 4 different areas. One is the largest one is the Andaman Nicobar Island. The second one is what we call it as the Gulf of Mannar, very close to the Rameshwaram as well as Sri Lanka. The third one is known as the Gulf of Kutch. And the last one is in the Lakshadweep. The entire Lakshadweep is formed by the corals. It's a coral island, we can say it's a coral island. So we are fortunate to have a corals, and these corals are nothing but the small animals. These animals are what we call the polyps, and these polyps are present on a calcium carbonate background. And these corals are having an association with the plants also. The plants are nothing but the zooxanthellae which prepares. There is a symbiotic association of zooxanthellae, that is the plants and animals. We can give a very good example for symbiosis, that is plants and animals interaction, that is one is what we call it as the coral reef. So we have coral reef, and these coral reefs are the nursery grounds for many of the turtles, many of the fishes. And this is the most important breeding ground for many of the fishes also. So we are fortunate to have 4 coral reefs in India. Next one, please. Now, coming back is a very small slide. Nearly 35 phylums are present in India. 35 phylums are present in India. And we are fortunate to have nearly about 429 species of mammals. About 2,600 species of birds, about 439 species of amphibians, about 640 species of reptiles, nearly about 3,000 species of fishes, which include the freshwater fishes, the estuarine fishes, and the marine fishes, nearly about 3,000 species of fishes. We are fortunate, nearly about 5,040 species of mollusks. We are about 4,000 species of protozoans. So we are having a huge number of animals that are present in 35 different phylums. Among them, The most important one is known as the insect. Insect is the major, next one please. The insect forms a major junk or major group of animals in entire India. As many as 66,000 of animals, 66,000 of what is known as these insects are present. 66 among 1,6,666 species of animals, we are nearly having 66,000 species of insects. So you can imagine how much important that is. 60% of the animals are the insects alone. Among them, three or four groups are very important. The Coleoptera, which is about 18,000, the dipterans, the flies, which is about 8,000 species, and more than 20,000 species of Hymenoptera, and about 12,000 species of 12,000 species of Hymenoptera, that's ants, bees, and wasps, and nearly about 17 species of butterflies. These only the butterflies, not the moths. The number of moths is comparatively about 45,000 species. So you can imagine how rich we are today. Next one, please. So in addition to that, for conservation, we have many acts are also, many acts, Fisheries Act, Indian Forest Act, Wildlife Protection Act, National Forest Policy, Forest Conservation Rules, Biological Diversity Act of 2002. This is the how we have a very wonderful biodiversity profile in India in terms of plants, in terms of animals. Only unfortunately, we have not identified how many species of microbial or plants that the viruses and bacteria are present in our country. So this is how I will end with my lecture with a quote. Next, please. Now we need to protect this great earth. There is only one earth. This we need to protect. We have to prevent the loss of the genetic diversity. We have to save the species from becoming extinct, and we have to protect the ecosystem from the damages so as to promote a sustainable utilization. With this, I convey my sincere thanks to Professor Ayyappan and all the members of KSTA and all the staff of KSTA for giving me an opportunity to speak on this occasion. Thank you very much. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much for a wonderful presentation. Sir, too much I talk. Very, very informative. Friends, Gila Bada help out there. Biodiversity issues are second few only there, sir. So, too much help out there. Too much an hour YouTube Jana President upload Martive. Good, sir. We are very grateful to you for your time and wonderful presentation. Honorable Chairman, is there a question? Ayyappan, sir? Hello. I'm a KSTA member, Professor Mudimani. Thank you for your words, sir. Mudimani, sir.
It was a wonderful talk. I only can say thank you very much, Professor Ramakrishnan. It was a great talk and wonderful information about this biodiversity, how rich we are in the country. And only thing is, you know, this climate change, how we are going to preserve this biodiversity in the light of climate change, you know, where we may be falling behind.
Is a question for me, sir?
Yes, sir.
I'm the officer also.
Sir, climate change is taking a havoc for all of us, whether it's in agriculture, whether it's the biodiversity in the wild or biodiversity in the culture. So we need to look into from the various angles of the climate change. It's a very big process, difficult to understand the thermal profile, the carbon dioxide profile, the methane profile, and the various profile that takes care of these plants and animals. So it's a very big question, sir. It takes quite a lot of time for me to answer this one.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Saidapur, sir. Mr. Saidapur, sir. Professor Savitri, madam. Savitri madam. So, sir, thank you very much for a very wonderful informative and scholarly talk on biodiversity. I'm sure students would be highly benefited by your talk.
I couldn't unmute on time, but I think it was a wonderful talk and very well presented and with lot of data. I am sure it will be of great help to all who are in, all those who are interested in biodiversity. Thank you very much, Professor Ramakrishna.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you very much, madam. Sir, thank you very much for your very insightful and scholarly talk. We are grateful to you for your time, and also you have given us your brief note on your talk, which we will be bringing out in the form of a compendium. Thank you very much, sir. Ramakrishna sir, thank you very much. Sir, tomorrow Mulimani sir, naale organic molecules bagge on talk ide by Dr. Arun Isnu. Thank you, sir. Ayyappan sir. Professor Ayyappan sir.
Yes, yes.
Ramakrishna sir, the mugitu talk.
Adhe nodide tumba thanks. Mattomme Ramakrishna sir, tumba chenagittu matte nimma slides galu. It was a visual delight, you know, for your lifetime experience that you brought before us. Grateful to you from the KSTA. Thank you very much. We all enjoyed our talk. Tumba thanks, Dr. Ramakrishna.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Over to Dr. Ramesh, please. Dr. Ramesh. Hello. So namme ellarigu ellarigu tumba dhanyavaadagalu Professor Moolimani avarige, Professor Saidapur, Professor Savitri, matte namme mattire iruva ellarigu tumba dhanyavaadagalu. Thank you very much. We'll be in touch once again. Dr. Ramakrishna, thank you very much.
Namaskara. Thank you. Thank you.